Is this my mic? Well, go ahead. All right, to pass it around. And then you can start reading, my sister. You can start reading and they expand on that a little bit.
Okay, chapter two.
Chapter two.
The cutting of covenant. The blessings of Abraham, your blessings, are based upon a covenant relationship with God. Before we explore these powerful provisions, it is important for you to understand what a covenant is and the terms upon which your inheritance is based. A covenant is an agreement between two people that involves promises on the part of each to the other. The Hebrew word for covenant is barah, which means cutting. Biblically, this refers to a custom in Old Testament times where two people making a covenant pass through the body of slain animals after making their agreement. There are actually six elements to a covenant. Content. What are the promises being made? Cause. For what purpose are these promises made? Commitment. There must be a commitment to the covenant from both the giver and recipient. Confirmation. Both parties confirm their acceptance of the covenant. Conflict. Conflicts will arise as the covenant is enacted and fulfilled. Continuum. The covenant is eternal, perpetual to all generations. We will observe each of these elements in the Abrahamic covenant. We will learn the content of the covenant, the cause for which it was given, the commitment of God to the covenant, and the confirmation of its truth as it is fulfilled. We will witness that despite conflicts such as Abraham's advanced age, the covenant is fulfilled and its promises passed on to future generations. The Old Testament contains many examples of people who related to each other through covenant. David and Jonathan entered into a covenant because of their love for each other, an agreement which bound each of them to certain responsibilities. 1 Samuel 18:3. Other examples of covenants between men are both Abraham and Isaac with Abimelech, Genesis 20 and 26. Each covenant contained 56 elements. Cutting covenant. When one cut covenant in Old Testament times, it involved a statement of the terms of the agreement, an oath from each party, a curse upon each if one shall break the agreement, and the sealing of the covenant by a blood sacrifice. Violation of such a covenant was considered a heinous act. The truly remarkable thing is that God, who is holy, omniscient, and omnipotent, consented to enter into covenant with sinful men. In the Old Testament, God made a covenant with Abraham and his seed.
Okay. Stop there. Let's kind of go over this a little bit for us. See how you where your mind is. Did you catch anything out of that?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Go ahead. Teach us.
The cutting of covenant, just how covenants were made back then, and I like the meaning of it is cutting. And there was the six elements. I like it because they had to be, you know, what promises was being made and that whole process.
So what was the purpose of the covenant? Why did they enter a covenant?
Why did God enter a covenant with them?
Why did they enter a covenant?
Because God wanted to solidify or whatever his promises.
You know, she's a Christian. She's such a word of figures out loud.
To form a relationship.
Yeah. See, a covenant makes it personal. See, we enter into a covenant, it's an agreement, and it makes it personal between us.
Mm-hmm.
You understand?
That's good. Yeah.
So, not everybody is blessed or fortunate to enter into that agreement. It's because we have something to share with each other, right? So,
right.
But there is there are principles. One of the things that we need to understand, there are principles in the covenant that we must accept. All right, and we talked about ratification last week. Everybody know, everybody remember, anybody remember what that word means? Ratification?
To ratify, to make.
Yeah, ratification, to ratify.
To make right.
Somebody said that, but. Right, right, to, there you go, to agree to it. Basically, when the covenant is ratified, the blood is what ratifies. Make it binding. Thank you. So the blood, the shedding of the blood of animal says that the agreement now is legal. All right? And you can't break it. If you break it, then, you know, you default. And the benefits that's in it is removed. Because remember now, covenant also has benefits in it. Mm-hmm. That's why you sign it, because you want to get something out of it. So we enter into an agreement. Let's say you're an artist and you sing very well, and I say I'm going to manage you at 15-20%, and we come together and we sign. You have to perform. If you don't perform, then you can't get the benefit that's in the contract. There's an obligation for me as well to perform. I gotta find their gigs, so it's two-sided. Contract is not one-sided. Okay, anything else? Right? How we sign, what's the ratification of a contract now, today? How do we ratify a contract? Signature? What does a signature, what is a signature? What do you use?
Ink.
Pencil. Okay. But to me, the signing of the agreement is what really is what's important. Because if you don't sign it, then right. Yes.
Okay, but see, that's not all true.
Tell me now.
Okay, because I work in contract and I've been sold for 23 years. Mm-hmm. Okay, a contract for us that's legal and binding is the moment we accept payment. You give me your credit card, that contract becomes valid, it's legal and binding, and you get your paid contract in the mail.
Okay, now, she's right. She's right. That's one kind of a contract that couldn't work in court.
Right. Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Because if you and I have an agreement and it's not signed, I'm talking about, let's say, manager and artist, for instance. Because I, you know, then, you know, if it's not signed, then it's not binding.
Right.
Right? So she's right. Yeah, it's not signed, you know, you don't have it because it's a piece of paper.
You don't have to pay.
But lady, there are different kinds of agreements, different kinds of contracts. Now, can you use, this is very important now, can you use a contract that's expired in court to win a case?
Yeah.
Go ahead, I want to hear you. Jeez, talk to me now.
In the area of the effectiveness of a contract. That's where you can use it in court. Yeah. If you did something and I have a year contract, mm-hmm. and within that year, that effective date and that expiration date, something happened, okay, and you have documentation of it.
Okay, amendments.
Yes.
Okay.
Not amendments, but you have documentation of what you did, okay? Say for instance, okay, my husband, he's an AC man.
Mm-hmm.
He goes to customers that have contracts. If he go out there during the course of their contract and he does something to tear up their air conditioner or something like that, okay, and they just kick him out the house, you know, blah, blah, this, don't worry about, and the contract comes to the expiration date, then if they decide to seek legal matters on it, the attorney is going to ask, I went to school for paralegal too. The attorney is going to ask, okay, for all documentations within that year, okay, that the time that he made the problem. So that's what they're going to go from. Now, if they choose to not do anything and they go into another contract, then that nullifies that year. Because the attorney is gonna tell them, well, if they did this during this year, and you turn around and you renewed your contract, why did you renew your contract when you had this problem? What it is you was telling the company that the problem is okay, so I'm gonna go ahead and renew it.
Okay.
So they can't, you know.
So there's a warranty that's binding.
Right.
Okay. All right, that's cool. Yes.
And then the school system, so if something happens in the classroom, right? And I make a document of it, and I have the parent sign it. Sometimes they will come back and say, well, it didn't happen like this, and it just whatever, for whatever reason. We pull out our document. It might have been a year ago, we pull out our document. There's a signature, there's no other thing about this, and you have to provide that whatever year.
All right, listen to me. Remember now, we're talking about covenant with God versus what we do. We fluctuate and we're legal. You know, I'm not an attorney. So it's a little different because there's so many different kinds of contracts. But the basic principle is what I'm trying to get, is that you have to honor your agreement. When you start walking with Christ, when you start walking with Christ, and you enter into an agreement with Him. Now, I know we're talking about the Abrahamic covenant, and this is why I send this around, because we talked last week about the Abrahamic covenant not standing by itself, right?
The Abrahamic covenant does not stand by itself. Over here, in the Old Testament, and I should have put Old Testament, over here, it stood by itself. And before we get here, you have the Abrahamic covenant, and the only participants were Jews. No Gentile could participate in this unless they were converted to Judaism. So in order to participate over here, because God was only dealing with this one man, and we're going to talk about the new covenant is not with individuals. The new covenant is with Christ, right? And then we embrace Christ and then participate in the blessings. All right, we're going to talk about that a little bit. But only Jews could participate over here, and you could only do it through natural birthright. So you would have to be born a Jew to get the Abrahamic blessing. All right, over there in the Old Covenant. But now, in Jesus Christ, you just need to be a believer that gives you the new birth. And that new birth will participate in the Abrahamic blessing. All right? Cool? All
right.
All right. Get some more. All right, my sister, you can go ahead and read for us.
With Abraham and his seed, stated the terms, swore by himself and sealed the agreement with the blood of sacrificial animals. In the New Testament, this covenant was reconfirmed through the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ. The Greek word for the covenant used in the New Testament means a contract or a will.
Right.
Simply stated, our covenant with God, based upon the Abrahamic promises, is the title deed to our inheritance.
Mm-hmm.
It is a legal, spiritual binding agreement between God and man. When God called Abraham to leave his home and go to the promised land, he declared that he would make Abraham a great nation with many descendants.
Mm-hmm.
In Genesis 15, Abraham questioned this promise because of his advanced age, mm-hmm. and the Lord reaffirmed it. Abraham's response is a model of believing faith.
Mm-hmm.
And he believed in the Lord, and he accounted it to him for righteousness, according to Genesis 15 and 6.
Mm-hmm.
Genesis 15 describes the ceremony commonly used in the ancient world to formalize a covenant. The custom was that both parties making the covenant would walk together between the pieces of slain animals, according to Jeremiah 34, 18 and 19. This meant that the terms of the covenant would be mandatory on both parties.
Right.
If one party became guilty of violating any term of the covenant, it would free the other party from the necessity of fulfilling his own promises.
Yes.
But the ceremony which occurred in Genesis 15 between God and Abraham confirming the covenant was different in one very important aspect. And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram. And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between those pieces. In the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, according to Genesis 15, verse 12, 17 through 18.
Let's read that, please. Let's read that.
Genesis 15.
Yeah, let's read that for clarity. Right there?
Yes.
Okay.
And when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, a horror of great darkness fell upon him. It's 12, 17, 18. And it came to pass that when the sun went down and it was dark, behold, a smoking furnace and a burning lamp that passed between those pieces. In the same day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates.
All right, so what was the promise there?
Verse 18, in the same day of the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates.
Now, you know that's the issue today, right? The land. Because somebody said it's mine. Because God gave it to me. He gave it to my daddy. And it belonged to me. Alright? Hold on, sister. I'm going to come back to you in a second. Because I want to deal with this for a second. The natural blessing that God promised Abram, are we entitled to it? The land over there. Are we entitled to it?
I would say so, yeah.
You say so? We go get some of that land?
He said, unto thy seed.
So are we the seed of Abraham?
In Jesus. In Jesus. With Jesus Christ.
Yeah, y'all confusing me. Are we seed of Abraham or Jesus Christ?
We're the seed of Abraham.
The seed of
Christ.
Christ, okay. So do we get some of the land?
No.
Why not?
Because that land was promised to the seed of Abraham, which was back in the Old Testament, the Jews.
Right? What? What did you say? Did you say we have the seed of Abraham?
Yeah, through Christ.
So does that entitle us?
I think it entitled us to everything, but for us to go over there and stand on their land and say, okay, this was, you know, God said I inherit some of this land. I mean, they're
going
to
have
everything.
I'm just trying.
Verse 19, so, it says the Canaanites and the Kenizzites and the Canaanites.
Okay.
The covenant opened up to us, not only to Abraham, back in the Old Testament, Abraham, Jew. The covenant is for everybody who believes in Jesus Christ.
I'm trying to search. I'm searching out the class. I mean, it's okay to have opinion. That's great. I like the argument. I want to know decisively, are we part of that blessing today? Do we get some of that land? I don't like the yes, no. I need to know. I'm gonna ask you individually. Are you part of the land? You're gonna get some of the land.
Yes.
Yes.
Why? Why? Why you say yes?
Hold on, man. This is good. I need to know before I leave out of here, because I'm going to go over there. I'm going to take my machete.
Okay.
All right, hold on now. This is good stuff. Wait. Yes. What'd you say?
I mean, looking at, I'm going by what I see in the scripture. I mean, he gave it to him, and he did say see, but what I'm struggling with here is 19 say the Kenite and the Kenizzite and the Kadmonite and the Hittite and the Perizzite and the Rephim and the Amorite and the Canaanite and the Jergesite and the Jebusite.
Which eye are you?
Yes.
I don't think
I
participated
in
those eyes. Which
eye
are you?
Okay, so you said no. Yes or no? No. Yes, yes, no.
Yeah.
Yes, yes. You say yes?
Yes.
Yes. Three yes, one no.
Believers, yes.
Hmm? Yes or no? Yes. All right, don't play a trick on me, Mom. Okay, are we going to get some of that over there? Can we take a plane and go say, I'm in Christ, Abraham seed, so I can't come from my land? Can we do that?
That's what you're saying. No. Right. You can't ever do that
now.
No? Yes, I said yes.
Me too.
So we've got four yeses, one no, two no's. All right.
Yes, the New Jerusalem. Glory.
Yes, New Jerusalem. Okay, so you're yes.
Yes,
we're going to clarify that, okay?
We understand. You're saying right now, can we go over there and claim it right now before the coming of Christ?
God promised Abraham
right.
The land.
Right. He promised Abraham and Abraham's seed, right?
Yes.
We
don't rule
the land.
Yeah, so are we part of that?
Today.
Today. So we got two no's and the rest yeses.
I say
no. No, three no's.
Yes, we are.
Yes. All right. All y'all say yes, I'm gonna give y'all tickets.
Okay.
And you go over there and whatever place you want to stand on.
We get homestead.
When you get there, you don't need to identify yourself. Just say, I'm Abraham seed through Jesus Christ, and this is mine.
We know it don't work that way.
You know what I mean?
No, it don't work that way. Right, we can't do that, but...
All right, here's the thing. The principal fact of the covenant that God made with Abraham gave him legal rights through that covenant. Okay, now when Abram... Every place that his feet touch, you were talking about taking out the sword and slashing stuff. When he did that, then the spoil became his. That's how they got it back. Right? They go fight, they're running off the folks, the Jebusite, and take the land and all the golds and everything that's out is theirs. Right, because they are the conquest. They conquered the land and took it legally. God gave it to them so they could. It's theirs at that time. Okay, the difference today. Well, first of all, let me just stay there for a second. The blessing was only to the natural seed. Okay. The natural seed, and it was more than just land, all right? Because you're also talking about the forgiveness of sins, which was the most important thing. But I don't want to go too far there. But no, we're not entitled to that land. And why do we have to go all the way to get over there to get land? Why don't we get it right here?
Because we're not gonna be
here.
Doesn't it like she said, when Christ come back, we're gonna rule. So all of it is gonna be ours.
We're gonna rule here in the land.
How many believe that Jesus was wealthy when he was on earth? Jesus owned everything. How many believe that?
Not in the natural.
It was poor?
Yeah.
The carpenter's son?
But he wasn't poor.
All right, let's not use the word poor.
Yeah, he was not poor.
But did he own all the land that Abraham, his father? Because Jesus is the son of Abraham according to the flesh, you know that. Right? So did he own land?
Right.
I don't want us to get focused because a lot of the tricks that the enemy play, he played it in the financial realm.
Yeah.
And I'm not saying not to pursue wealth because you can work it. But the scripture says godliness with contentment is great gain. Right? So last week we talked about how we tap into the Abrahamic blessing. It is through Christ. Because the natural part of the Abrahamic blessing was closed in Jesus. But then the spiritual part of it exploded in Christ. So we went to 2 Corinthians chapter 2, 5, and it reads, if any man be in Christ, then he now is entitled to everything that God promised Abraham. So you cannot get it by yourself, or you cannot get it through natural birthright. You have to get it through Christ. You understand what I'm saying? A lot of the Jews today, and I was at a dysfunction today where today's the Passover. Big. Really huge. And they're still connected. A lot of Jews still feel entitled. You understand? And if you're around Jew like I am, I mean, you get the sense like, you're nothing. I'm serious. I mean, nothing to put down, you know? It's just that, you know, they understand, and they really believe that Abraham is their daddy.
Yeah.
If you go back and read the scripture, let me use this, and look at the challenges that Jesus had when he was teaching. Some of the greatest challenges that he had was with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. These were elites. These were the guys who had everything going on for them at the temple. And they could not fathom Jesus born in a manger. Because you have to understand, they were looking for the Messiah, but they were looking for the Messiah to come through the lineage of David. And that means he was supposed to be seated on the throne of David. So when he came that way, we kind of strayed a little bit, they were dumbfounded. They couldn't embrace that. You see, and this is why. But if you notice, they would tell Jesus, look, I'm not listening to you. This is what our father Abraham said. Jesus would come back at them and say, before Abraham was, I am. And then he would say, well, Abram rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and he glad. So they were claiming Abraham, but what they really needed to do was claim Christ, because the work of Abram was fulfilled in Christ, is what I'm trying to show. So the Abrahamic covenant does not stand independently. It doesn't. It no longer stands. It used to. Where you couldn't get to God because God established that one man, Abraham, and you have to talk to him to get to God. Everybody understand?
Yeah.
Right? So you couldn't, you know, you have to, Father Abraham was the man, he was the God. Now, when Christ came on the scene, all of that changed. Because, and this is why I said this around, because what I want to show you in this is that there's a difference between Jesus and Christ. Jesus is the son of Abraham according to the flesh.
Right.
That's his offspring. That's where the genealogy came from, brother. But Christ, Abraham is a son of Christ. You see what I'm saying? That's what the difference is. So you cannot compare any of the covenants. The other covenants
funnel in Christ and it ends there. It stopped there. Now, every promise that's spiritual that's supposed to come over here to us, come on now. Yeah, there was some stuff that came out. Right? The natural side did not come out. Because it's not about land anymore. It's a, remember the Bible said God showed him a city not made with? Okay, what was that saying? That's us. What the Bible said, Abraham looked for a city. Hold on, I got to share something. Abraham was one of the wealthiest men on planet. I mean, the old stuff that, not even, I mean, he was filthy rich. Didn't pay no attention to it. When the Lord told him to get up and leave his country, he left his inheritance with his daddy.
Right.
He left everything. He walked out empty-handed because he embraced the covenant more than the money. Because what he was seeing was something that was far greater than what he had back over there in Babylon. We have to understand that this covenant gives us a lot more than natural stuff. If you're just thinking about just becoming rich, then you're going to be deceived. Wow. I guarantee it. There is a funny thing about money. But I'm not, don't get me wrong, we got to balance this right now. Because we have benefits in the covenant and money's in it. But you can't set your heart to it. If riches increase, set not your heart to it. So you can be rich, don't get me wrong. But we're not thinking about going to get no land because we don't need it. Because everything we need is in Christ.
Amen.
You understand what I'm saying? In fact, if you go over and talk about get some land, they're going to cut your hand off.
Oh, your feet.
You might not even get
the land, or they're going to hurt you.
They're going to ask you who? Because you have to understand that the natural Jews, right? Some Jews right now, really believe in the old covenant.
Yeah. They're still waiting for the Messiah.
That's, a lot of them are.
Is that the reason why they're going back and they're, well, if you watch, you know, television on Sunday morning, they're asking people to give donations so that they can send the Jews back over into their land.
That's a part of prophecy.
But that's prophecy.
Well, I know that, but I'm like, is that why, you know, we're giving our money for them to go back into their land?
Well, some of it is business. It's politics. But there's a prophecy that say, you know, and it's arguable. You know, this is not the place for it, you know, because everybody has their own opinion on that kind of stuff, you know, because it goes into a whole nother level. But let's give them the benefit of the doubt that they are still, the problem is that we have some Jews who don't see the Messiah.
Right. You have some Messianic Jews, and then you have some Jews that just don't. They have not embraced Jesus. They're exactly. Still living in the old covenant, especially the Hasidic. They definitely are not embracing. They're not Messianic. I mean, they're not Messianic. The Messianic Jews are the ones that
believe in the Messiah. Yeah, I wanted to find out. There's a temple near where I live. And I always see them going to this building and they wear this thing on the wall. I don't know what it is. Do you know what it is?
A yarmulke.
It's not a yarmulke. There's a beside the yarmulke is like a piece, and it looks like this.
Is it like a hat?
Oh, yeah. It's not a hat. You know what I'm talking about? I will find out what it is because it looks magnificent. It does. So I watched them go to this temple, and I said, let me go see what's going on. Me and my curious self. I try to get in there, they pull me out. I couldn't go nowhere. I couldn't go in.
Well, you know, they have stated, I watched an interview last night, and one of the
high class, what they call rabbis.
Yeah.
He says, we're not going to change.
I'm telling you.
They're not going. They don't.
It is a, it's seated. It is that you can't, Moses to some Jew is the champion. And they don't understand that these men, right, embrace Christ. Because Moses said to the children of Israel in prophecy, he said, the Lord your God is going to raise up a prophet like me.
Yes.
He's talking about Christ. He said, when he comes, you must embrace him. That's what he said. So these guys embrace Christ. Now, when you get to the New Testament, when Jesus left the wilderness and came back after 40 days, what was the first thing that he did? He was baptized.
Yeah.
What happened at this baptism? A voice, right? Why would a voice come and say that?
God's
making him known?
Yes.
So it was confirming the covenant.
Affirmation service.
All right, so if you was at Jordan and you heard the voice, now, aren't you supposed to be following Jesus from that point?
Yeah.
But they was out to kill him.
Yeah.
We have the same thing today. Let me give you some information. When you become part of the new covenant, you done put a target on your back.
Yeah.
Because, yeah, seriously. And if you think that, I'm not talking about folks don't like you on the job, that's nothing.
Mm-hmm.
In comparison to what goes on in the spirit realm,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Because you're now a covenant partner in the kingdom. Yes.
Just a real quick testimony on the Jews. About 2 years ago,
yes.
My first encounter with a Jew was on my job.
Yes.
And he simply asked, tell me about this Jesus you always talk about.
Yes.
Because I always used to stop him with his language. And when he get to cursing the Lord, I said, hold up. No, we didn't want that, you know. But that brought me into leading him to Christ. And how did I lead him to Christ? I showed him the lineage of Jesus.
You did?
He started reading in Matthew. And in about 2 hours' time, he was so amazed that he's on the phone. And he's calling his other Jewish
You're
brothers.
Serious?
Calling his mother, saying, Mom, y'all did not tell
You're
me.
You serious?
I lived with him for 9 months, didn't know why I was there. Lived with him and his wife for 9 months. They both came and accepted the Lord. But I'm talking about this man literally could almost recite everything that he was reading. And that he, I was just like,
okay, okay, okay.
Because he did not know. And he said, all they teach them is about Abraham. And I'm talking, this is a 40-something-year-old man that has all the things wrapped around and when he's praying, all the stuff going and all the dress and everything that goes to the temple. All that. But did not know. He said, why did y'all not tell me that Jesus came and gave his life for me?
What a name.
And he was going and telling other Jewish brothers about, he said, read the New Testament. There's more books.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
See?
I mean, and all I did was let it, you know, how sometimes we think, but praise I told God. You have to accept
That's
Jesus
wonderful.
To make it in.
Hallelujah. Beautiful. Well done. We have a lot to do. We have a lot to do. You know, a lot of times it's not just about us. First, we need to get an understanding, because when you're talking to a Jew, he's going to tell you about the covenant.
Oh. They know.
They go. They really know.
Yeah, but now Passover, they sit there and they recite.
Oh, without a doubt.
And you know, every Passover, they say the whole story.
Everything you were talking about entitled to. This was a confession he made immediately and stopped immediately. Every single morning, he would go by McDonald's, take the same cup, fill it up, go to lunch, fill it up. And I'm like, but they're spilling. And when he read about Abraham, how when Sarah, you know, and he didn't accept the money for the burial place, the man literally cried. He said, I'll never take, his father had pizza places in New York and everything.
It's entitlement, it feels entitled.
Took from people because he was a Jew.
Yeah.
And felt like they could go and take these people's money on the corner that his dad had.
His job.
And so they feel that way. They feel they're entitled to take whatever, wherever they're at, they feel entitled to take whatever they want.
Exactly. They walk with it, they walk, you know, feel the.
Today, they feel that way.
So, you know, so this is a good class.
Go ahead.
You all right, sir?
Yeah, just back trouble.
Oh, back. All right, let's move on because I don't want to stay here too long. So thank you. I know you didn't get to finish, but did you say something else you want to talk about? What you just read?
I mean, it's really good. I mean, as I look at the Abrahamic covenant, it's basically telling us, pushing us into the place where to walk upright with God. If you look at Abraham, by him leaving there, by him leaving his familiar territory, he did it by faith.
Okay. So you're gleaning from that.
Right. That's what
I get
from it too. Okay. Yes. I like what she just read about. Did you get to it when they walked between them?
I don't want you to. I want to talk about the Abrahamic or the Abrahamic covenant, but I don't want you to get too hang up there. Let me tell you why, and I'm going to be careful when I say this. It's because we're dealing with Christ. Yeah, maybe I'm trying not to say it. We're dealing with Christ. We're talking about our rights now in Christ. So really, to talk about the Abrahamic covenant, you really need to talk about the new covenant, because that's where everything is. It's in there somewhere. So we don't have a right by birth. We could never, you know, as long as Jesus was alive, no Gentiles could be saved. You remember the Syrophoenician woman who wanted them to heal her daughter because she was sick? What he told the Syrophoenician woman, he said, look, I can't give you the children's to dogs. That's what the Gentiles were. Not necessarily four-legged, but just the depiction. They didn't have any rights to the Abrahamic covenant. So as long as Jesus was alive, we couldn't get nothing. But it's when he said it is finished, and he gave up the ghost, the spirit, then the middle wall, the wall of partition, was destroyed, and we became part of the Abrahamic covenant. But now, through Christ, okay?
I did that.
All right. So thank you. That was good. Go ahead, sister. Wait, what did you stop at? You can tell her where you stopped, and then we'll continue from there.
Abraham and God did not walk together between unclean animals, as was the custom. God put Abraham in a deep sleep, and only God can the form of a covenant and a flaming torch walk away from the disobedience. This means that the fulfillment of the covenant is based solely upon God's grace, regardless of failures by Abraham or his descendants. Abraham could not be responsible for the covenant, but could only be a recipient of the covenant. He might fail, but the covenant will remain intact. God would never fail, for he promised, my covenant will not break, nor alter the thing that has gone out of my lips. Psalm 89:34.
Yes.
You are a recipient. You are a recipient of this powerful covenant with all of its promised benefits. It is passed on to you as the spiritual seed of Abraham. No matter how often you fail, no matter how weak you think you are spiritually, the covenant is not dependent upon you. You are only a recipient. The fulfillment is based solely upon God's grace.
Hold on. Go back up and then read it again, and then we're gonna just want to stop there for a second. Let's park there for a little bit. Go ahead.
Which part do you want
to
go back?
Go back up just a little bit.
Okay. You are a recipient. You are a recipient of this powerful covenant with all of its promised benefits. It is passed on to you as the spiritual seed of Abraham. No matter how often you fail, no matter how weak you think you are spiritually, the covenant is not dependent upon you. You are only a recipient. The fulfillment is based solely upon God's grace.
So the covenant is not, it's not with you directly. The covenant is not really directly with you individually. Right? Who is it with? The covenant is with
God.
With who? Why am I getting so many different answers? Who's the covenant with? It's not, you just read it, it's not with you. So who is it with?
It says it's based solely upon God's grace. Because normally you have two parties and you have to pass through the animal. But Abraham never passed through, only God. His son. We're recipients.
Okay. So we make a covenant with who? With Jesus, who is covenant with God, right?
Yeah.
Because the covenant is between. Remember we said, this is my beloved son?
Yeah.
And whom I'm with. Here's the thing. Jesus is our mediator.
Right.
Right? Everything that we need from God, we got to go through him.
Yeah. Oh, man, come on to the Father.
Right. You know, because the covenant is with him. He's making, remember I told you that he's not making the covenant. He didn't make a covenant with his descendants. He made the covenant with Abraham. It's an everlasting covenant. In other words, it didn't matter what they did. It didn't matter what they did, how messed up they, that's why God would always honor his covenant. Because it was not contingent upon what they did. So they would mess up. The only thing that would happen when they messed up was they got rid of them.
Yeah.
But the covenant still stood, right? Between him and Abraham. The function was still good. Nothing was wrong with the covenant. The principles were still good. The benefits were never changed. As a matter of fact, let's go to Jeremiah 31 real quick. I want to show you something. Jeremiah 31. Let's go to the 37th verse. I want you to see something here. If you find it, read it.
Thus says the Lord, if heaven above can be measured and the foundations of the earth searched out beneath, I will also cast off all the seed of Israel. For all that they have done, saith the Lord. Man, not land.
You finished?
No, I actually haven't written.
It's finished? You're through?
You want me to read out?
Yeah.
Okay. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that the city shall be built to the Lord from the tower of Hananiel unto the gate of the corner.
Uh-huh.
And the measuring line shall yet go forth over against it upon the hill Gareb, and shall compass about to Goab. And the whole valley of the dead bodies and of the ashes and all the fields unto the brook of Kidron, unto the corner of the horse gate toward the east, shall be holy unto the Lord.
Okay, all right, hold on. Thank you, Pastor. Good to see. What I wanted to see there was the promise that God made. Say, if he can move the sun out of the sky, if he can do that, and you can put all the stars down and let them fall to heaven, from heaven to the ground, then there's no way I'm going to change my covenant. So the covenant stand, right? Nothing that anyone can do to change it. Now, how do you get the benefits out of the covenant? That's the key. Because it's not automatic. You're not entitled to it. We're not automatically entitled because we're, you know what I'm saying?
Believers. Huh? That's a
believer. You have to tap into it to get it. Right? So, if you reject, it still belongs to somebody else because it's not about individuals.
Amen.
So it's important to understand that even if you fall, you're still not, it's not going to be yanked away from you. You can always tap into it because it belongs to you through Christ. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. All right, sister, you can go ahead and read, continue.
You are a spiritual heir of every blessing of the Abraham.
Right.
The words bless and blessing are used repeatedly in these promises. The root word is barak. It means to confer abundant and effective life.
Right.
And to endure with power for success, prosperity, and longevity.
Mm-hmm.
The blessings God conferred upon Abraham, which are passed on to us as a spiritual seed, endure with power for an abundant, effective life. They assure power for success, prosperity, fruitfulness, healing, blessing and longevity.
I like that. So even though we're not able to take a plane and go over and get a piece of the land over there, we can still gain.
Okay.
You can still get stuff. You never know, somebody might say, hey, look, I'm going to put you in my will. Yeah. This is yours.
Right.
Somebody walk up to you and say, here's a key. You know? That's what you get from out of Christ. It's not because you're part of the natural. You understand? Because the natural, you're not entitled. So you're not looking to get anything from natural. You understand? You get it through the spiritual realm of Christ. You see? So all of that, sickness, you can be healed. It's a part of the covenant. Right? Financial blessing, you can get it. It's a part of the covenant. I'm going to get mine a little bit. I'm so thinking now, I'm about to go talk to the banker. You can get money. Why aren't we trying to get money? It's a part of the covenant. What do we need to do? Now, don't go rob a bank.
Buy gold.
You go start something.
Not just wait for measures.
You go start something. We can have a lot. I think a lot of us don't have, because the Bible said we have not. We ask not, you understand?
So the key
to this covenant, the new covenant, right? The key to the new covenant is faith. Right, you tap into it through faith, but then you have to accept the new birth principle. Yeah, because if you're not, remember now, you're not entitled if you're not a part of the family. So back then you have to be a Jew, a natural born Jew, and that's why they feel like they're still entitled. Go next to a Jew who understands the old covenant. The aroma, the expression, everything about them is, I am entitled. It's mine. That's my daddy. That's all that thing. We have to have that same attitude in Christ.
Yes.
We are covenant people. And everything that's his belongs to us.
Amen.
But don't confuse it with the natural part of it, because you can never tap into the natural. It's over.
Even my marriage.
Don't get me no trouble. I'm not going there. No, what I'm talking about specifically is the land. You understand what I'm saying? So we have to move from the natural to the spiritual, because the covenant now is dealing with spiritual exposure. Right? So if you have it backwards, you're wrong. You're going to have problems, because you cannot want to... You're more spiritual than natural. That's all I'm trying to say.
Yeah.
You're more a spiritual person. Yeah, than a natural.
Yeah.
Right. So you have to set up your spirit man to tap into. All right. Let me say it one more. Let me say it another way. You see, Abraham,
I told you that Abram was filthy rich, but he was never focused on it.
No.
Because the Bible said he saw a city whose builder and maker is God. So if he's seen a city, then the man must be walking in spiritual realm.
Right?
Right? And he could only tap into that because he was covenant. But you cannot get nothing out of heaven without a covenant relationship with Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Nothing. So this is why when you talk about that Jew and how he was so, you know, he didn't see it. We have a responsibility to show them. Because a lot of them will not embrace the resurrection. So you think we're not just here for us. You know, the new covenant was made with the house of Israel and the house of Jacob. Yes, it was. It was made with them first. They received the gospel first. So you know, not all Jews are blindsided. But those who are not, we need to talk to them. We need to. We have to do ministry to them. Because they don't see the new covenant as something to embrace. They live by the old covenant. So they embrace Sabbath. Anybody here keep Sabbath? Not a trick question. I just want to know. No? I hope not.
No, but you know, there are a lot of believers
that
are going back. That are going back.
Yes.
To Sabbath.
Going back?
I'm talking about born again Pentecostal folks who are now embracing Sabbath. And they're worshiping on Saturday.
So they went back.
Why would you think?
And I'm not talking about the 7 day Adventists.
You're talking Pentecostals.
I'm talking about people that I have been in fellowship with.
Went back.
Who say now they've got a greater revelation and Saturday is the day we should worship.
Are you talking about like Israelite people?
No.
Okay, just regular people.
No.
Yeah. Well, the Israelites, Israelites are black. They're the black people that, you know, want to say, you know, Jesus is black and all that.
Okay. All right. What do you just stop at, my dear?
Right for the verse.
What chapter? One more.
At the promise.
Okay. All right. Did you finish that up? Did you elaborate on that a little bit?
No, I didn't.
Go ahead.
But I definitely like the part when it talked about God putting Abraham to sleep and he ratified the covenant with himself. And that way, Abraham, even if he failed, he would still be eligible for his seed. You know, would still be able to obtain the covenant, be part of the covenant. So that I really like that part. And then it talked about it being based solely on God, for you know, that we will receive all the benefits. So,
hallelujah.
Yeah, I think that's very, you know, that is, I like, you know, when that. I read that, I was like, wow,
that's powerful.
I like that too. So because that way, like, that was the custom of the that was the custom for men to do it. So it took men out of the equation, and God just did it himself. It moved men out, and God just did it. So he, like he always does, just when Jesus came, changed the custom, you know, changed the status quo. He moved men out, and it was solely based upon him. I thought that was
and even understand that normally when it comes to a covenant, there are two, you know, there's between two parties,
right?
And that both parties have to pass through those animals. But because only God did it, you know, again, going back to the part, you know, even if we fail in holding up our end of the agreement, that covenant still stands.
I like that. I'm thinking a lot about that. That's been good. All right, that's it. So are you saying that us, we here today, when we fall, we're still entitled?
Yes.
Why?
Exactly. Say that again.
No, because of Jesus. Because the covenant is not directly with us. We are in Christ. So even when we fall. See, there's a lot that goes on with the covenant because you have a mediator. John, 2 John 2:1 says,
yes.
We have an advocate,
right,
with the Father, right?
Right.
And that's why Sunday when the apostle allowed me to speak, we'll talk about that capital sin, right? That capital sin, once it's removed from the believer's life, you're no longer under Romans 8:1. There is therefore now no condemnation. Right, to them that are in Christ. So you have to understand that God understands your frame and know you're going to fall. So you still have rights to it because you're in Christ. Amen. Yes.
Yeah, but when we fall, some people take it to mean that you fall no matter what you do, you still have to accomplish still there. But when you fall, you have to do something to get up and go out again.
Yeah, but you don't lose the covenants. The covenant is with Christ. See, let me be honest with you.
Where before
we even get there, and that's a whole other subject. But let me just say this to you. Where I came from, right, when you sin, remember now, there is no degree in sin. Right? Okay, no, I mean, there's no big sin and little sin. I mean, they're different punishments, but it's still the same sin, right? But here's the thing. If the Lord understands your thoughts are far off, and he knows what you're thinking way before you even start thinking, and he knows your frame, because you're not going to surprise God by your fall when you fall. God is never, if you can surprise God, then he stopped, he can't be God.
Amen.
So, if God understands your frame, and he knows that you're dust, right, and he knows you're going to fall, he's not going to judge you because you make a fault. The problem is that we don't repent.
That's right.
That's the problem.
So yes, like she said, you know, it could sound like once saved, always saved, but that's why we got to say, you got to, because that's why there's Christ. Because of Christ, there's repentance. Because of Christ, when we fall, we no longer cut off. We no longer die. We no longer drop dead because we have that advocate, you know. But sometimes it could sound like once saved, always saved.
I don't know that doctrine and what they're trying to get out of there. I'm not going to teach that. Maybe a different class. But listen to me. I'm just saying this real quick. The covenant is not with you.
Right?
Right? Remember that we talked about Jesus being the Lamb covenant. There's a covenant between him and the Father. He came to do one specific thing, shed the blood. And the blood is going to establish the new covenant. In the new covenant, those who are in Christ are protected. God is not going to kill you because you fall. Now, I'm not encouraging sin. Right. But where I come from, they kick you out of the church. Uh-huh. Yeah. Oh, well, don't. Some of us deserve that. But hold on, beyond that, let's do restoration. Yeah. So I'm not, you know what I'm saying? Everybody understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I'm just saying that we need to understand our rights. Each of us in the sight of God, precious pearl. Your covenant person. And remember what we said before, that I'm not gonna make a covenant with you if I don't like you. No. Well, I can like you, but I'm not gonna make a covenant with you if I don't trust you. We're not gonna enter into an agreement if I don't have some, if I don't feel a certain way about you. Am I saying that right? In other words, it's not everybody gets the right. Some, you know what I'm saying? So when you're in that covenant relationship, it's a special thing. All right, you finished? So you like what you said there, right there? God said, I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna fix it.
Amen.
I'm gonna make sure that you covered.
Exactly.
Even when you fall, I'm still gonna have something there for you. You can look at the prodigal son. And you can see the prodigal son, but the father never threw out his blessing. The prodigal son, his stuff was still at home. His father was just waiting for him to come back. Because it was always there. It never left with them. Portion went with him. But his blessing was still at home. So please don't throw me away. Because a lot of the times, if I check your closet, then you need to go too. You understand what I'm saying? I learned this a long time ago. I'm going to share this with you real quick. I'm going to move on. When I was back up north in Delaware, I was an assistant pastor. And because of my teaching, you understand, rugged and, you know, just bang, bang, nail, you know. And something happened between a sister and a brother, you know, in the church. And the way it was handled, and I was a part of it, killed them. You understand what I'm saying? It killed them, and it didn't have to be. You know, we could have handled it differently, but it's how you approach it. In other words, and I said to myself, I told someone, I said, I would never, ever, ever do it again. You understand? So it's how we handle. We have to understand that each of us have a relationship with God, and we made a mistake. I don't know how you set up, but I made a mistake. Man, you will sin even in your sleep, thinking about stuff. So we have to be careful. God is not about that. He's not about throwing stuff out. We're covenant people. I might have said too much. Read for me. You add covenant is based on relationship.
The blessings of Abraham.
Well, let me start that.
The promises were spoken to Abraham and to the seed. The scripture does not say and to seeds, meaning many people, but and to your seed, meaning one person who is in Christ. Galatians 3:16. The blessings of Abraham were given from God through Christ to us. If you are a born-again believer,
right,
these blessings are yours.
Right.
This is what makes an understanding of the covenant vital today. Many believers are living far below their spiritual heritage because they do not understand that this covenant extends to them.
That's what we're talking about.
They do not understand its provisions or
right,
how to receive the right, benefits. This lack of knowledge results in many living defeated and desperate lives. God's word declares, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Hosea 4:6.
Yes.
The provisions of this covenant are yours, passed on to you from God through Jesus Christ.
Right.
The covenant is confirmed in your life the same way it was in the life of Abraham. Jesus Christ walked along to Calvary and through his blood sacrifice, my Lord, paid the price for your salvation and the spiritual benefits of this covenant. Can I just stop right there just to expound?
Yes.
That paragraph right there to me is just like parallel to the where God walked between the animal, put Abraham to sleep,
yes,
and walked between as a sacrifice. As Jesus Christ walked along.
Wow.
You know, so
she touched it.
Yes, she did.
She touched it. Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Right.
Wow.
And,
wow.
So
So it's confirmed in him. Jesus.
So now he which established us with you in Christ and hath anointed us is God, who hath also sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. 2 Corinthians 1:21-22. The fulfillment of this covenant is not dependent upon you. It is only dependent upon your obedience.
Wait a second now.
Obedience.
Wait a minute now.
Better than sacrifice.
Wait a minute now. So are you saying that you have nothing to do with the contents? You didn't write it? You didn't put nothing in it? Everything came from God. And the only thing he's asking of us is obedience.
Obedience.
Okay? Now, we could get into some of the principles of the covenant, but we won't. So go ahead and read on there.
It is only dependent upon your obedience in accepting and acting upon the terms of the covenant.
That's it.
You must believe in Jesus Christ and accept him as your Savior in order to become the seed of Abraham.
So explain the term of the covenant.
Explain the
term. Yeah, what would be the terms
of the covenant? It would be to obey. Jesus.
Okay.
And then you have to then follow where he follows his.
So you need to understand what's in the covenant. So the covenant is not just a blank piece of paper.
Right.
There are some stuff in it that you have. In other words, back on the old covenant, you had circumcision. That was part of the covenant, right? And then there had to be followed, right? The male had to be circumcised.
Right. Is that what you're asking? What is in there?
The new covenant. What are some of the things in the new covenant that we have to follow?
Believe in
Christ.
The Ten Commandments.
Is the Ten Commandment part of the new covenant?
Yes, it is.
It is?
Jesus part of both. Yeah. Loving our neighbor.
Ten Commandment part of the new covenant?
No.
The love of God and the love
of God. Huh? Yeah. It's about confessing with our mouth the Lord Jesus.
So, what is the difference between the Ten Commandments and the New Covenant?
I don't know. I'm not sure if I understand. Well, I understand the question, but I mean, I would think the Ten Commandments is the foundation of the Old and the New Covenant. Because the Ten Commandments still stand.
So you've got to do that.
Right.
Now, all right. Now, you're right. But let me explain something to you, if you don't mind. Okay? As the Ten Commandments that was given to Moses, right, that were placed on a rock, on two tablets, right? Were set up in a way where if you didn't follow one, you're dead. He's just going to kill you, right? We don't see it that way because Jesus said there's two coming that hang everything on the law. So we don't keep the Sabbath day. In other words, if you don't keep the Sabbath day back then, you're dead. We don't keep the Sabbath day today, or do we? But that was a part of the Ten Commandments.
It was.
So how do you take one out and not do the other?
Right.
You cannot You cannot keep it according to the what was written in the stone. You have to keep it now according to what's written in the heart. So now you're dealing with what the Holy Ghost is doing. So when you embrace Christ, you become a covenant person. So you automatically stop stealing. You automatically respect your parents.
Right.
But it is not because it's written in stone. It's because, right, see what I'm saying? So, but it's different because you can't simply still keep the Ten Commandments, because then you're going to have to go back to the principles.
Right. Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
And if you didn't function according to those principles, right, you're dead.
Right. Plus, Abraham was prior to the Ten Commandments.
Correct.
That's what people don't realize.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. This is very important what she just said.
Don't realize that.
You know why it's important? Yeah, because it was a guideline only for Israel coming through the wilderness. Mm-hmm. Only, that's it. The Mosaic covenant is only for the children of Israel coming out of Egypt. Right. When Jesus said
that we shouldn't live even above that.
You're better.
It just means that it's written in our hearts, and if it is we've accepted the Lord Jesus Christ, and if it is that we're saved and sanctified, then the Holy Spirit is at work within us to take us from strength to strength and glory to glory. And if those things are things that we're not even tempted by as we grow from strength to strength and glory to glory. So it's not like he came to fulfill. So it's not like we're throwing them away.
No.
It's standards to live by. It's just that we're not living as they were in those times.
You're not living by the principles.
Principles, mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because if you live by the principle, like when Paul says in Galatians chapter 5, that if you're circumcised, if you use circumcision as a part of God's righteousness today, mm-hmm. then you're falling from grace. Mm-hmm. If you practice circumcision as a righteous angle for God to bless you, then you're falling from grace, because circumcision profits nothing on the Christ, all right?
I'm glad, I like that explanation.
Well, thank God for that.
I would
thank
always get that. Hung up on that Sabbath.
Yeah, like, it's because it's, yeah, thank you, Jesus.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, to them, it was not just that; it was ceremonial stuff.
Ceremonial.
Everything.
We're not even on their calendar,
on their time. Yeah. So we're not a part of that system at all. Because if we were, we'll be in trouble. Well, we need to start with.
Okay.
What
sayeth it?
What chapter? Are you, what page are you on?
10.
You said on 10?
10.
I thought she did 10. I'm sorry. Okay, okay.
I'm about to finish.
Okay.
But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Mm-hmm. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, mm-hmm. thou shalt be saved.
Right.
For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made
right.
unto salvation. From 10:8-10.
Mm-hmm.
The promises of the Abrahamic covenant are attained by grace through faith, just as your salvation is secure.
Amen.
Mm-hmm.
For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It mm-hmm. is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians 2:8-9.
Okay. All right. Here's my question to you and to the entire class. Does the death of Jesus automatically save us? The death of Jesus.
What do you mean? You said you have to confess with your mouth and believe in your heart.
But I've heard preachers said that Jesus did it all, done it, I have to do nothing.
No.
Because Jesus did it.
No, we have a responsibility.
Did it all, or what are you
we
doing?
Have a part.
It's ours.
Yes, it's ours.
So you have to believe, right?
Yeah. And confess with your mouth
and believe in your heart. So I'm in the right church. Okay. All right, so you elaborate a little bit more on that?
Oh, I mean, that's what I, when you were asking me, what were the, you said it wasn't principles, but I guess steps or whatever, that's what I was saying, is that you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. But with the heart, man believeth. And how you know a man believeth is he starts walking out when he believes.
He
studies the word, and he starts walking it out. A lot of people say with their mouth, but their walk don't follow what they say. So
wow, they say stuff and don't do it.
Right.
Okay. All right. Mother, are you ready for your part? We're going to go to chapter 11, and I can start reading. Is that page 11?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah. No, I'm sorry. My mistake.
You don't know page 11? The covenant is based on relationship.
Yes.
You cannot enter into this covenant without a personal relationship with God. It is not what you know about this covenant, its terms and provisions, but who you know that will make these blessings a reality in your life. God's covenant with Abraham was based on relationship. Abraham was called the friend of God.
Thank you, Jesus.
And the scripture was fulfilled, which said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness. And he was called the friend of God, James 2:23.
Thank you, Jesus.
How do you become a friend of God? You accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and develop personal relationship with him through prayer, praise, and worship. The word of God, living by his precepts and doing his will.
Amen.
After God gave the powerful promises of this covenant to Abraham, he commanded that the agreement be confirmed by the shedding of blood. Abraham was commanded to circumcise himself and all the males in his household. This was a sign of the covenant relationship between God and the nation of Israel. This is my covenant which you shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee. Every man child among you shall be circumcised, and you shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you. And he that is 8 days old shall be circumcised among you, every man child in your generations, he that is born in the house or bought with money or of any stranger, which is not of thy seed, he is that is born in thy house, and he that is bought with thy money must needs be circumcised, and my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant.
Mm-hmm.
And the uncircumcised man, child, whose flesh of his foreskin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his people. He hath broken my covenant.
Stop, Mom.
17:10-14.
Yeah. Explain on that. It's a lot there. Go ahead. You, circumcision. Do we still do circumcision today?
A lot of them don't. I know my parents did. I don't know how some of them do. I don't know, but they cutting off the the covenant, the commission God gave for a man to multiply.
Oh, you're talking about the foreskin. So
disobedient.
So God still requires circumcision today, right?
Of the heart.
There you go.
Of the heart.
Yes. So under the old covenant, it required only of the male. Exactly. Back then, there are other things, you know, they deal with their trimesters and stuff like that. That they had to follow and stuff like that. But today, the heart is where we do the circumcision, right? The heart. And that is what God requires. So now, instead of circumcision of the foreskin, it's circumcision of the heart. That is what binds the covenant, right?
Yeah.
So whether you're circumcised or not, that's a personal thing. It's up to you and your family. It's nothing to do with God anymore. Because the covenant has changed. It switched from the natural to the spiritual. Circumcision of the heart is not you go to the doctor and do something. It's a faith thing. Yeah. Everything about the new covenant is faith. Yes. You tap into it and get out of it safe. Your faith is like a hook. Right? You want something and you send out the hook and it taps into God and it pulls out. You don't send no hook in, nothing comes out. Right? So you have a responsibility. Saints don't understand that you gotta get up and you gotta make it happen.
Yes.
Everybody should be in prayer service. Because faith cometh by what?
Hearing by
you reading?
No.
The reason why God sets up leaders is because they are conduits.
Yes.
He flows through them.
Yes.
Be careful of people who say they have their own anointing. And they don't want no leadership. You understand? God sets up the leader so he can flow through the leader because he's not going to come to you. Yeah. I mean, don't get me wrong. As far as direction and order and principle, it's covenant. It's a covenant thing. And the reason why the covenant is with Jesus and God and not with you personally is because whatever you ask in words or deed, you got to tap into Christ. Because he's the one who's going to go up to the Father.
Right.
I'm not a Trinitarian, so don't get me wrong. But he's the one who's going to go into the presence.
Yeah.
Because he's now the high priest. And the high priest, that's what they do. They go into the holiest of holies on your behalf. You couldn't go inside there. It took the priest. And because the priest was anointed to go in. You understand?
Yeah.
So that's what Jesus does. He takes your request to the Father. Because that's his function. His function is the high priest, and he's making things right for us. He's giving us, but it's your faith that taps into here. So you don't need to keep the Sabbath physically. It's not going to do you any good because there is no function in it anymore. It is not the principle that taps into God. First, that's how he taps into God. You have to do these things, these ceremonial things and this ceremonial thing. And that. No, now your faith alone will get you what you need from God.
Amen.
Because that's how the covenant is set up now. It's a new covenant. It's a new thing. It's a new movement. So we have to know what the new covenant offers. So this is what I'm trying to tell you. I know we say the Abrahamic covenant, but you have to understand the difference between the natural part of it and the spiritual part of it. Mm-hmm. Because the Jews still hang up on the natural part.
Right.
And God forbid, some Christians still do.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They're still trying to get the blessings of God out of the natural. You can't.
Mm-hmm.
There is no function. The only way you can get anything from God is to tap in it through Jesus Christ. And a lot of people missing that. Nothing goes out of the kingdom unless it filters through Jesus. Through that covenant relationship. And remember what you read? You didn't put no terms in there. We didn't put no, it had nothing to do with you. There's no request. That's between, you don't understand what's in the covenant. You're talking about getting land. You're talking about getting glory. You're talking about the new Jerusalem. You're talking about being a part of the. You don't know what's going to happen when you go to the kingdom. So you're in the covenant. You're in the covenant relationship. We're in a good place. All right. You finished? Mom? You want to say a little bit more on that?
During the long journey through the wilderness, the Israelites did not practice circumcision, but it was resumed again before Israel entered the promised
land. Right, right. You can read the scripture.
Will we go on?
Yeah.
At that time, the Lord said unto Joshua, make the sharp, these sharp knives, and circumcise again the children of Israel the second time. And Joshua made him sharp knives and circumcised the children of Israel at the heel of the foreskins. And this is the cause why Joshua did circumcise all the people that came out of Egypt that were males, even all the men of war, died in the wilderness by the way after they came out of Egypt. Now all the people that came out were circumcised, but all the people that were born in the wilderness by the way, as they came forth out of Egypt, them they had not circumcised. For the children of Israel walked 40 years in the wilderness till all the people that were men of war, which came out of Egypt, were consumed because they obeyed not the voice of the Lord.
Well, there's another piece to
Go ahead. Swear that he would not show them the land which the Lord swore unto their fathers that he would give us, a land that floweth with milk and honey, and their children, whom he raised up in their stead, them Joshua circumcised, for they were uncircumcised, because they had not circumcised them by the way. And it came to pass, when they had done circumcising all the people, that they had abode in their places in the camp till they were whole. And the Lord said unto Joshua, this day have I rolled away the reproach of Egypt from off you. Wherefore the name of the place is called Gilgal unto this day.
Okay.
Joshua 5:2-9.
All right. So we understand that the circumcision back then was a painful process. And they had to be contained or, you know, put in a special place until they were healed.
Healed, made whole.
You know, made whole, and then they could, because it was a very, it was a lot of noise. Thank God. We don't have to do that anymore. We'll get in trouble. We cannot cry. Grown man will cry. So, you know, so we thank God that we have moved from that process to a new process and we just believe.
I have to laugh because my middle son was circumcised, and he was circumcised before he came home from the hospital. So during the time, they put him in these little straps, stirrups, you know, to do it. And the doctor came and he said, that's one strong boy you have. He busted the strap.
I would too.
I felt so bad for the poor child.
Hey, I thought about that. And I said, you know, they didn't have knives like they do today. You know, they use some really dull knives like that. At least it wasn't, they weren't sharpened like how we sharpened our knives. They were probably sharpened by stones. So yeah, the process was very painful. And we're not talking about babies. We're talking about grown men.
Right, which is even worse.
You know, so this is, so there's a lot. There's a lot that we need to understand what happened back then, and how we are so grateful for Jesus and how he brought everything and made
it.
And now we don't have to go through all of that anymore. All right, let's read on. Thank you, brother. That's good. That's good. You said some things on that, right? Yes. No comment on that. All right. Pick up from the Israel.
Israel could not suppress the firm enemy, and receive the benefits of the covenant with Arthur.
You want the mic on Mother can't hear.
You don't want no mic.
Mother can't hear.
Here's my mic.
The cutting of the flesh was a sign of the Abraham, if Abraham has a covenant with God and his people, but what does circumcision represent to the believer today? As a people called, having by God, desiring to walk in the covenant,
we're recording.
We must bear the mark of change upon our lives.
Testament believers, we are no longer circumcised the flesh, but we are circumcised in heart. And him also was circumcised with a circumcision, not made with hands, but in a spiritual circumcision, performed by Jesus, by Christ, stripping away of the body of flesh, the whole corrupt carnal nature with its passion and its lust. I have a problem hearing my voice.
That's okay, you're doing very good.
Thus, you were circumcised when you were buried with him in your baptism, in which you were also raised with him with your life through your faith in the working of God, not displayed when he raised him up from the dead. And you who were dead and trespassed and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, you your sinful and carnal nature. Mm-hmm. God brought it to life together with Christ, having freely forgive all our trespasses, having canceled and blot out and wiped away the handwriting of the note, bound with its little decrees and demands, which was enforced and stood against us, hostile to us. This note, with its regulations, decrees, and demands, is set aside and cleansed completely out of our way by nailing it to his cross. Colossians 2:11-12.
All right, you can stop. I have a problem here.
To me, it's like an echo that.
There is a whole lot there.
You know, I have a problem with.
It's okay.
That's all.
Hallelujah.
We got it. You don't need to explain nothing. We got it. You just did everything. Do you have any comment on that?
On
what you just read. There's a lot there. A whole lot.
This the circumcision that we're talking about today is the circumcision of mostly the heart and not the foreskin, cutting away the physical foreskin, but it's the cutting away of the heart, the change of heart, our transformation in Christ. All these laws and rules and all like that, but in Christ we have something different. We have a new life. We have a complete transformation in Christ, other than the one that was in the Old Testament.
So you're saying that what they did in the Old Testament was an act that they couldn't look for, they couldn't perform.
No, they really.
That's why they was failing. Yeah, they were failing, right?
Right. There was problems with that.
Right. There were a lot of issues with that. Mm-hmm. So you're saying to me now, these issues that the scripture is talking about was removed by Christ. Right? Because we couldn't. You realize that, right?
We will have problems with the same thing. We will have the same problems.
There's some serious words in here.
Yes, Lord.
Hostile to us? Hostility? There's some other serious words here. Legal? Right? Whatever Christ did, right, it was something that was embedded in. It was written in our flesh.
Right.
Yes.
Written.
Guilty.
Yes.
Right.
So, exactly. So, when God saw you, before you become part of the covenant, when God saw you, he saw hostility. Towards him. This is why we must be born again.
Yeah.
Because if you're not born again, then you're automatically a part of condemnation.
It helps us to get rid of our transgressions.
Yeah, but here's a point. And this is a good point. This is a, I'm gonna ask a question. Now, if Christ got rid of all of that in the flesh and made us covenant people, are we, when we sin, are we back to that point?
What point?
Austerity. Are we still looking funny through the eyes of God? Mm-hmm. How does God see us when we sin?
He sees Jesus.
Talk to me now.
Mm-hmm.
To the covenant.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you don't see us this way anymore.
But we see ourselves.
Sometimes. That's what I'm trying to get at. Why do we see ourselves like that?
Because sometimes, I mean, a lot of it has to do with the way we were raised and what we were taught and what we have to be untaught. What classes like this teach us is unteaching us a lot of what we were taught when we were young.
We have a lot of people who shouldn't have left, but left. Who shouldn't have, it's just a lot of the wrong teaching, yeah. What was echoed to us,
yeah.
And they echoed it to them, and every generation get the same, and nobody's tapping into what Christ did. He unseated condemnation,
you know,
and placed, yes, this apostle.
One thing that has been
possible since.
Go ahead. Got
more
out than I got out. Go ahead.
No, Apostle, we're waiting on you.
Go ahead. As you said, you know, a lot of things were preached at us.
Yeah.
We heard. And I don't believe, and I've been sharing this, me and Tara have been having these discussions. And until you really tap into the kingdom, you know, we are in a religious, I mean, there's some things I had to go back and say, that ain't right.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because I got, when I understood kingdom, mm-hmm. it brought a completely different revelation.
Yeah.
And so, we have carried on things for so long, and to be honest with ourselves, when we come into truth,
mm-hmm.
okay, and be able to cast out the old and embrace what God has, then we can embrace the promises.
Yes.
But,
right. Yeah. And it's a struggle too. Because a lot of people don't want to let it go.
They don't.
Tradition is
they don't the tradition and religion. Religious, mm-hmm. religious nature. But we also know that we were taught by those who thought that they were teaching the right thing.
Right.
So we can't really, you know, just kind of be upset. We just have to realize, and this is why I think that it's so important. I think it says it in 1 Corinthians 13 when it says we see through in part. Yeah, I mean, and I believe as every generation comes, he reveals a little bit more to it. And it is our responsibility then to change the conversation.
Right.
Not that we're changing the word, because
right.
if we change the word, we're in trouble. But the revelation that he's giving each generation,
mm-hmm.
it's important that we're doing what we're doing here and teaching
mm-hmm.
it. Because if not, you will want to sit under the Ten Commandments still, thinking that, you know, oh my God, you know, I don't keep the Sabbath. I'm a terrible person.
Right.
Not realizing that Jesus Christ came to fulfill that, and he gave us that new.
Yes.
But it's not to say that those things are terrible. It's just to say that there's a different way that we deal
right.
with those things.
Different covenant.
Mm-hmm.
It's a different covenant. You
were
saying
that Marta said the traditions of men make the word of God of none effect.
Right.
And so many people are stuck on traditions that it is causing them to be selfish and unconcerned about others because they are determined not to change,
mm-hmm.
but according to the Bible, it says we're supposed to be changed from the natural.
Can I ask
embrace and knowledge. Yes, that's it.
Go ahead.
The thing that
you should know. I just want to say, you know, based on what I'm learning here, it just basically showed me, you know, about the Abraham covenant, the reason why, you know, God did what he did through Abraham. For us to come, son, so we can mature.
Right. Right.
That's what I'm
Right, so because we talked about the Genesis, remember Genesis 22:18, that if the Abrahamic covenant or the Abrahamic covenant was two part, because Christ was also establishing that covenant. And he was the one who was established to bring all sons into the kingdom through that covenant. So the Abrahamic covenant is a very powerful covenant.
Yes.
Very, very, very strong. Let me ask, how many religions do we have today in America? How many different religions?
Five major, right?
We have over 30,000. And count different religions, which means you have to know what you believe.
That's right.
Because all of them is based on here. Remember now, when Satan went to Eve, he didn't go on his own, he went with the word. He said, God said, but then he twisted.
Yes.
So we have to be careful. What is the fuck? The church. There's only one church. This is why it's important to understand religions. Because there's only one church, one set of principles. And that's where the kingdom is. Because like I said, God is not dealing with people. He's dealing with Christ. And the covenant is with him. So if you want the kingdom, find Christ. It's the way, it's simple.
Amen.
It's all
Amen.
Of it. Right?
Yes.
Thank you, my thank you. That was very well done. You did good. You did good. It says he set aside. Set aside. Meaning, how do you set something aside? You gotta take it, and then you take something and you put it aside. And then right? He
took it out the way.
He took it out the way. Clear completely. By nailing it. So to me, the nail represents something. It represents sin. Sin. Nailing it to the cross. So the death of Jesus was very significant because it had to do with sin being nailed. Because now Jesus Christ is taking over. He's taking over our lives. Okay, let me say one more thing before we go. See, when Adam sinned in the garden, we lost it. The kingdom, everything, we couldn't go to the kingdom. We lost it. So when Jesus went to the cross, he became the second Adam.
Yeah.
Right? Giving us the right back to the tree of life. And the way you get to the tree of life now is Christ, because he is the tree of life. And you can only gain life in him.
Yes.
You must believe. You must believe. You must believe. You must believe. It takes faith to get in, and it takes faith to keep you in.
Yeah, faith.
I thank God.
Thank you.
I thank God. This is a good place just to say thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
He's given it to us again. We lost it, but he gave it back.
Second chance.
Yes, he did. Yes, he did. Now we have that right. Thank you, Jesus. All right, read on.
Our circumcision is spiritual, of the heart instead of the flesh.
Right.
But if you have been circumcised in heart, there will be external signs. Just as the men of Israel had visible evidence in their flesh, you will act, talk, and live differently. Your life, your flesh, will bear the marks of the change, which are the signs of your covenant relationship with God. For he is not a Jew which is one outwardly. Neither is that circumcision which is outward of the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
But he is a Jew which is one inwardly.
Mm-hmm.
And circumcision is that of the heart, in the spirit, and not in the letter, whose praise is not of men, but of God. Romans 2:28-29. This circumcision of the heart is twofold. God has a part in it, and the Lord thy God will circumcise thy heart. Deuteronomy 36.
Mm-hmm.
You have a part in it. Circumcise yourselves to the Lord and take away the foreskins of your heart. Jeremiah 4:4.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot do your part until he does his part.
Mm-hmm.
That would simply be a futile attempt
mm-hmm.
at self-improvement.
Mm-hmm.
The Apostle Paul declared, we are the circumcision which worship God in the Spirit and rejoice in Jesus, in Christ Jesus, and have no confidence in the flesh.
Mm-hmm.
Philippians 3:3. Our spiritual circumcision enables us to enter in by the Spirit, not the flesh,
mm-hmm.
to the covenant blessings of Abraham.
Mm-hmm.
The Bible teaches that man is body, spirit, soul, and spirit.
Mm-hmm.
When we accept Christ as Savior, the change is a spiritual one. You experience a spiritual rebirth. John 3:5-8. It is your spirit that is born again. After your new spiritual birth, your soul, which is your mind, will, and emotions must be supernaturally changed as you live out this new life. For years, your soul has ruled your spirit and your flesh. Whatever you desired, you did. Whether it was drugs, alcohol, pornography, immorality, etc., you did not exercise control over emotions such as anger, unforgiveness, and bitterness. You went where you wanted to go and did what you wanted to do. Repetition of sinful behaviors leads to more of the same, until certain actions are so entrenched in our lives that we cannot stop. We become enslaved to habitual sin and spiritual strongholds as erected. This is what the Apostle Paul struggled with after his conversion and described in Romans 7:15-21. You cannot change your soulish nature on your own. Self-effort will not rid you of habitual sin. Paul found that out. Addictions cannot be broken through self-effort. You must let God supernaturally change your soulish
yes.
realm, your mind, your will, and your emotions. For years, your sinful, soulish nature has controlled your body and your spirit. Now you must learn to let your redeemed spirit control your body and soul. The covenant promises made to Abraham are not for everyone. They are only for those who have entered into the blood covenant with Jesus Christ by accepting his sacrifice for their sin. It is for those who have circumcised the flesh and bear the marks of change upon their lives. It is for those who obey God's directive to step out by faith and claim the promises. Do not be afraid of the knife of God's word as it marks your life. The reproach of Egypt's sin must be rolled away. You must put off the filth of the flesh.
Stop, teacher. Go ahead and respond on that.
There's a lot there.
A lot.
I mean, simply put, you have got to, you've got to submit yourself to accepting the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And you've got to understand that in this spiritual rebirth, you're now letting go of the flesh and you're allowing your spirit to rejuvenate your mind
mm-hmm.
and your body, so that when you're coming into Christ, it's not from self-improvement, but
mm-hmm.
it's through the Spirit
mm-hmm.
improving your soul, your body, your mind, your will, your emotions.
Okay.
If you don't submit, then you're trying to do the work that Christ is going to do in you if you let go and let God.
That's beautiful. I want to say this. That's very, very nice. Are we spirit? Or are we spiritual people?
Yeah.
We are created spiritually, right?
Yes.
So the covenant that God made with us is with our spirit,
mm-hmm.
not our flesh. You know that, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everything that we do in our bodies are practice behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
It requires, it is no different than you disciplining yourself to exercise,
mm-hmm.
taking out time to exercise. I mean, I'm having a struggle with that. You're taking out time to go walk. I mean, it's a committed effort that will allow you to find a goal, set a goal, and then accomplish the goal. It's got nothing to do with God. You have to deal with it because it's a learned behavior. What God is concerned about is your spirit man. So he made a covenant with your spirit man. Remember, Adam was a spirit being before God placed him in the flesh. It's a different stuff. So what God is trying to protect is your eternal existence outside of his presence. You got to live with him because you were created to worship. So that's what he's trying to fix. Yes. Okay. So what we do in our bodies is our responsibilities. You don't have to do it. Right. It's just like making a commitment not to smoke. So it's lack of discipline. Christians don't have discipline. And a lot of the reason why we don't have money is because we're not disciplined. It's a practice behavior. We have the power over it.
Yes.
So, okay, yeah, you got to do some fasting. That's a part of the plan. Fix that. Because you don't have to be in any kind of, because your spirit is no longer condemned. Remember, there is therefore now no condemnation. He's not talking about the flesh. Is talking about your spirit man. You are no longer in condemnation because you are in Christ. All right? But not because you're in Christ doesn't mean you're not going to do some foolish things. You will, because until you grow up and become mature, then you will continue to do certain things. But it's not because you have to do it. You can't blame the flesh. You can't blame the devil. You can't say, oh, the devil let me do it. You can't do that. The devil don't let nobody do nothing. It's not the devil's responsibility. He comes to tempt, you don't have to do it.
And that's my thing, because we're spirit and what Jesus Christ did on the cross, we can, you know, because the Bible says, be ye holy, for I am holy. So we can, because there's no limit to the spirit. There's no, we can do it, you know, but like you said, discipline, we have to become more disciplined. We have to be led by the Spirit. And like you said, we must put these things off. And it is a discipline. It is something that we have to discipline, but we can't say, oh, God, I can't do it because God has not allowed me or equipped me to do so. We can because God is there for us to do it.
It's a mindset. It is a mind challenge. We have, and it's you want loving your body. One example, loving your body enough to go exercise. You don't want to have diabetes. You don't want to stay up.